it's a little sculpture.
It's very cute. And she's a public reader.
Thank you. Yes, I think it'll fit nicely. You're coming over tomorrow.
Yes.
We have to decide what we're gonna make. Thank you.
Yeah, so I'm putting, Nicole and I are wearing a mask just because we have to take a plane in a few days and we don't want to get a negative PCR test, but you know, it doesn't matter.
We don't want
to
positive.
Positive. That. No, that's the only reason. It's not, you know. But so yeah, thank you everybody for coming. That's nice. And most of you know me, but for those who don't know me, my name is Marceau. I come from France, but I live in California, in way north of California, 5 hours north of San Francisco, in a small little town called Freshwater. And I'm also an art teacher over there, and have my studio where I work in my house, where I live also with Nicole. And before I start, I just want to say a really nice thank you to Holger, first of all, to hosting us in this beautiful gallery. This is really nice. And Gretchen, thank you so much for putting all this together. All this is because of you. So this is really nice. And Danielle, thanks for letting me use your chateau to put the frames together. So that was nice. Before I start talking specifically about these paintings, I thought I'd tell you a little bit where I'm coming from inspiration, and how I think when I think about art, and then I can tell you a little bit more specifically about these works. So, and I have notes because I'm always nervous with these things, but from an influence point of view, things that influence me are, of course, it's obvious when you see it, you know, abstract or expressionist paintings, whether it's from, mostly from the American expressionists, because they, when I discovered them a few years back, they really helped me understand what modern America was, how it came, you know, because the abstract expressionist movement that happened post-World War II was a renewal in America, the time when America was trying to create a very standardized society through supermarkets and television and things of the sorts, and at the same time, through jazz, beat poetry, and abstract expressionism, there was a movement to sort of counter that. And I found that really fascinating, and when I encountered I'm more interested in art than I'm interested in music, but when I started to encounter this, it helped me make sense of this country, that's not my country of origin, and it allowed me to really get to know and study the artists that were part of this movement. And of course that influences me in the way I painted as well. But I'm also influenced by other works, and lately, more specifically, by Asian minimalist painters, Hideaki Yamanobe, for instance, so Suxia Bai, to name a couple, are painters that show me how minimalistic you can go in your abstract painting and yet convey something that has a lot of emotion attached to it. And so this is a little bit where I'm coming from. But mostly, I'm very interested in the Japanese aesthetic philosophy of wabi-sabi. A few years back, when Nicole and I took a long trip, a winding trip through Japan, and there I encountered this concept of wabi-sabi. Wabi meaning the beauty in things that are imperfect, things that are ephemeral, things that are broken, damaged, and sabi, the beauty, the inherent beauty that you can find in things that are affected by the passage of time. And it allows you to be confronted to visually to things that are as honest and pure as they are. And I find this to be a really interesting antidote to how modern society is always seeking and looking for the perfect, the trendy, the things that go against the nature of things. And so this is something Once we came home from this trip in Japan, I started paying more and more attention to things that are raw, honest, on the things that you don't hide, even though they may not appear as perfect. And I started taking a lot of photos around cities, mostly, because in nature it's a very different thing as well. It exists through decay in woods and things of the sort. But I started taking photos of places around the city where I would find the stains and things that are looking a little, they're not looking like whoever created them intended to be, because they were affected by the passage of time, they were affected by dirt, they were sometimes vandalized, they were sometimes attacked, and stained. And I started to see things that were really, really interesting. And I started making a lot of projects around these photos, including a residency in Barcelona. You can look at that in a little more detail later. A residency in Barcelona, where I exhibited the results of these photos to show a little bit how you can look at your city at a very different level and see things in an environment that normally you would either even avoid at best or not want to look at. But there is true beauty in there. And so if you look at the paintings, it starts looking like a little bit these surfaces that may not be surfaces that are perfect, or try to convey anything that is perfect. And then I started thinking, okay, how can I translate this into something that is interesting to me as well, not just visually? And I started thinking about what it means, the passage of time, and how it affects it. And I started thinking about time, what does time mean? And what is time really about? And little by little, I started thinking about time as a vessel. You know, the true measure of time is really, on a human level, the experience of it between your birth and your death. And so, you know, we all have this notion of, yeah, 1 hour is in an hour. But really, the true experience that we have of time can only exist as the time you experience it between your born and your death. And I started looking at it as sort of a vessel in which you place things. And what you were placing were experiences, but experiences, they're real for a fraction of a moment. What is left behind are memories. And these memories, I started thinking of them as traces that accumulate on this sort of vessel that time is, but really accumulate on one's soul, a bit like a patina. And the traces, when you see them accumulate and going over, and a memory that may be strong one day fades into another because it's replaced by something different, you're hiding memory, you bring them back, you're rethinking them, you're reinventing them. I started being more and more interested by these traces and started playing with the idea of, okay, how do I visualize them? How do I create paintings that make it look like these things that I'm thinking about? And so I started doing different series of the work. The first series I did was a series called Traces of Silence, in which I was exploring, well, these moments of silence that you're confronted in life, whether you want them or you find them. For some people, silence might be a little scary. For some people, it might be something you see because you don't have it, especially in the city. And what could silence look like if you were looking at it as moments in one's memory? And actually, on this exhibit, we exhibited together with Daniels, had works in that exhibit, sculptures as well, and it was at the Gallery Piante in Eureka, California. Then I did a series of works on another moment. It's an inconsequential moment that our lives are filled with, and these moments are doubt. You know, what is a moment of doubt? We constantly, through our lives, we're exposed to these moments where we're unsure about something. And I did a series of work about this on a project with the Catholic Church in France. The Catholic Church had invited me as part of a project where they're trying to renew the relationship between artists and the Catholic Church. they invited me to do some paintings for an abbatial cathedral in Wissembourg. And as an atheist, I had to find a way to create a body of work with that was would be paralleling biblical stories and so forth. And I decided to do that. The only way I could do this was to do something that was that I would feel honest about. And so the opposite of the of faith is not faith, because that's absolutist as well. The opposite of faith is doubt, and the Bible is just a bunch of collection of stories of doubt. Anyway, and so I created a body of work of painting that explored the idea of doubt in this cathedral. Then I did a series of paintings that explored that were a reflection, an interesting experiment with a friend, another artist from California, Natalie Craig, a dear friend with whom we have regular long conversations. And we decided to create an exhibit in which we would independently reflect on what does that mean, what does that leave us, these conversations. If you take the content of the conversation out, what we're talking about, what is left? What is left on those conversations? So we started working independently in the body of work of several paintings each, and created an exhibit for the Black Font Gallery in California, where on the day of the opening we unveiled the paintings to each other and see how they played with each other. And it was really interesting. There was a lot of dialogue between her paintings and my paintings, and she's an abstract painter as well. Then I did a series of paintings about memories, childhood memories that come back because some sense is triggered in a way. You know, you smell, for instance, for me, smell lilac, or smell freshly cut grass, or I hear a sound of a rusty machinery. There's these little sounds or senses that trigger a memory that is not really visual, but it appears in your mind and tries to. So I try to create works that that reflect on this memory. And then for this exhibit, which was supposed to happen last year, I decided to explore something. I wanted to explore something light, and I started to play with the idea of daydreams. And daydreams happen when you're awake. And so when you're awake, you have two realities going on, the one that's happening to you and the one that is happening to your mind at the same time. And those are the paintings, the diptychs, the four diptychs that you see. And all the paintings for the exhibits last year, which was supposed to happen last year before COVID canceled it, were about this idea of juxtaposing two realities. Which one takes precedence, which one matters most, that's up to you to kind of take a look. But I'm a daydreamer, and I'm fascinated by this. Moments where they dream and just go for it by a moment. And again, what does that look like? And I'm hoping to show through these diptychs that the paintings are, the contrasts are not too strong, they're not too big, but they're there, they're real. And yet they work together because they exist at the same moment. In a sense, one is not disrupting the other, so generally, at the moment it happens. But then COVID happened, and the whole exhibit was postponed by, well, I didn't know how long it was going to be postponed or if it were ever to happen again. And I started to think, it's like maybe it's time, it's a good moment to finish and close this chapter about memories. And so I created this new series of work that I called The Calm, the Storm, and the Forgotten in Between, which is sort of encompassing everything that I've been thinking and playing with. And I use the word playing because for me, painting is playing. It's a pleasurable thing. All this idea to bring back elements from all these different series that of work that I've been doing. And just looking back a little bit and hopefully closing this chapter and moving on to new things, but I don't know what they are yet at that point. So, how do I, process-wise, in order to create, to imitate what I think a patina, a soul with a patina would look like, and the patina coming from the accumulation of these traces, I paint using, well, I have paper sometimes, but mostly I use wood panels. I use wood panels because you can actually damage them. You can actually sort of torture them in a sense. Because I put a layer of paint and I scrape it off. I scrape it off sometimes mechanically with a brush or a scraper, sometimes chemically, sometimes even rarely, but sometimes with a torch just to play a little bit out. And of course, paper or canvas would be very difficult to do that. And so I like working with wood because it allows me to be a little more tactile and a little more, not violent, it's not the right term, but you can do a number on a piece of wood that you can't do on a piece of paper. And then I play with these layers of painting. So black and white paints are thick industrial enamels because it allows me to create a texture. I apply the paint mostly with a brayer or bottles or round objects. Because it leaves nice traces as well, and then I scrape them off and then play with oil, artist oils. These are all oil paintings, artist oils that have different transparencies. Some are very opaque, some are very transparent, and it just creates an image until I see something that I'm like, I like this, and I'm going to start right here. So, in a nutshell, this is it. So it's all about memories and an attempt to visualize what these, you know, the remnants of experiences as memories could look like potentially, and hopefully, and of course, you know, it is completely playful. For me, it's a playful exploration. I don't take this seriously. I just enjoy this idea and playing with it. So that in a nutshell is it. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them. Or hopefully it'll help you see them in a certain light or in a different light, or maybe it makes no sense at all. That's just up to you. But this is it. So, and there are a few works on paper, if you'd like to take a look at them. But they're generally sort of studies where I try, when I don't have time to start a new painting, I try with paper things a little bit and play.
And Marceau, do you work on one piece by itself, or do you work on several at the same time?
I can work in my studio, I can work with up to six paintings of this.
Okay. And then you just go back to those.
And I go back. Because it's oil, and so they take a long time to dry. It can take two, 3 days for a layer to dry. And that allows, I can also play with how the layer hardens or not. And I use a little thing called Japan Dryer, it's a little cheat sheet to accelerate the drying of the oil. But that has also given me a certain flexibility and another sort of tool to play with.
Very nice.
Anyway, all right.
Thank you. Can you tell me the names of some of them?
So, they don't have any different name. These are, they're part of the series. In this series, the small ones are a series called The Call of the Storm and The Forgotten Country.
Not one is
pour remplir, j'ai des trous, ça s'est arrêté, j'ai mis, ça perdait l'intérêt, pas du tout.
Alors parfois, parfois ça approche. Ici j'ai la grosse et puis vous et ma grosse. Mais en fait, c'est bien.